Hi, Sunil.
Hi, Sunil.
A very warm welcome and good evening to
Good
you.
evening. Good evening.
Hi, Sunil. Good evening. This is David Appasamy.
Hi, David. Glad to meet you. E meet you, as you say. Right.
Great. To get started, Sunil, firstly, a warm welcome. I wanted to introduce you as well. I think, obviously, we've been working together for the last 3 years, but for the benefit of our audience, even on LinkedIn, we are streaming live for some of us. So, I think just to get started, Sunil is a graduate from the Loyola College, actually. We shared our alma mater there. And then he went on to do his master's from IIT Madras as well. And then started his career in banking, actually, with SBI. Went on to Amex and then Bank of America before joining Sundaram Group. And I think the group's been able to hold on to Sunil's talent for the last 15 years. And he's risen from being a vice president to now the managing director at Sundaram Mutual, which is one of the leading mutual fund houses and AMCs in the Indian market. Having worked closely with Sunil, I can say with confidence that very few senior leaders work as hard and in terms of even connecting and motivating the team and the humble approach. I think that's something, Sunil, which definitely stands out in your leadership. So really glad to have you here to pick your brains on the topic hitting a six with Digi Retail. I know cricket is close to your heart as well.
Absolutely.
I think just to get started, on the Digi Retail part, I think if, maybe if you can just start with like a quick journey of the 15 years, how like things, how do you face those 15 years at Sundaram Mutual, right? When you all started, it was a very offline business, less regulation also, I'm assuming, with SEBI or AMFI, I'm not sure. I'm sure it was less regulated than now. We can see that, when I started my career in banking. So maybe if you could start your journey and just say how the phases have been, and then we can discuss on the Digi Retail part in more detail.
Absolutely. So basically, my retail journey started 15 years ago with Sundaram. My life prior, you mentioned banking. Actually, I was a corporate banker. And I never met a group of more than, say, 10 people at any time, right? And I was hired, God knows why and how. But the then MD of the company, I was looking for a job because I didn't want to move to Bombay. I was very keen on a job in Chennai, but it's a national footprint. And when this came up and I applied, and he said, "Oh, you're a corporate banker, but I'm looking for a retail head." So I said, "What are these? These are just names, right?" I said, "Ultimately, business is business. So how does it matter what it's called?" So he said, "Okay, I'll take a gamble with you and I'll hire you as my head of retail." Okay. So it was a leap in the dark for me, retail itself, right? And I was new to asset management itself. Okay. So coming in there, and clearly, Sundaram Group is a retail group. The parent, Sundaram Finance, is very retail. As a deposit-taking NBFC, it is considered safer than a bank. And it's a huge customer base and that. So when they started the company prior to my thing, they started the retail journey with the debt funds. But then when their partner left and the debt markets crashed, they suddenly switched to equity. And unfortunately, in equity, their journey then, which was 2002 to 2005, 3 years, was purely trying to make ends meet in the institutional and corporate side, right, with the banking channel and all that. And though their heart was in retail, they weren't able to kickstart. So they hired me to kickstart the retail journey. So I joined there, and they had about 22 branches when I joined. So my brief was to build retail. So I'm a classic brick-and-mortar, branch-by-branch, open branches right across India. And we took over 90 offices in the space of 5 years. And then what happened? 2008 crash happened.
Right.
And the bottom fell out of our business because you couldn't sustain. So there came a time in 2009-10 when I had to close down 50% of the branches
Now,
because they were not making ends meet. So I went and did that. And
because
then,
investors had stopped putting money into mutual
not
funds.
just investments, the market crashed. So the average AUM came down. So our earnings are based on AUM. And so when you have a physical office, there's a certain fixed cost which goes with it. So in a reduced AUM, you couldn't afford it, right? So, but I was end of the day, my heart was in retail. So the moment the market bounced back by 2013-14, I went back and put back all those branches. So that was the journey. And then that coincided with a lot of success. And so the retail really became a footprint of our company, right? And that success then naturally led to my becoming the overall head of sales and marketing as from pure retail. Then I became the deputy CEO. Then I started looking at the international operations. We set up an office in Singapore in 2014, so launched our fund there. And then we've grown. So then the whole digital piece, when it came together, right, was when the retail piece which came together, that's when digital was going up in the landscape. Okay. And typical to Sundaram, typical South Indian conservative mindset, oh, all this digital is just a flash in the pan. Today will come. Ultimately, people need paper to see. You know, all those mindsets. And I was guilty of those. Let me be honest and admit. Because having built the brick and mortar, they were close to my heart and doing that. So that's when my journey, and I must credit Ajit, who is my CMO today and who works closely with you all, right? He spent 2-3 stints with me. Actually, he's been like a prodigal son with me, you know. He comes in, sees an opportunity outside. He first went to Deutsche Bank, then came back, then went to Cognizant, then came back, then he went to Bank Bazaar, okay, where he set up their mutual fund piece. And that's when, in my mind, I started recognizing that digital was really the way forward. And so then what I did, I went and I met him at one of the events where he had invited me. And I said, look, I'm now serious about digital. But he didn't believe me first because he had seen the company. Then when I told him that, no, look, now I am the CEO and now I have charge of it and I seriously want to make a digital push, right? He came on board. So that was probably a turning point in terms of, because Ajit, and I still rag him this way. I still tell him that, you know, you learned mutual fund from me. And then I sent you, you know, to do an MBA in digital with Bank Bazaar. And now with that qualification, I'm rehiring you.
Right. We do have the privilege of having Ajit also with us today.
So the point is, so really speaking, the Punarjan, the Digi, so what I call as now we are calling it the Digi Retail Journey, started with that conceptualization. Now in digital, as you know, from 3 years ago to now, itself the world has changed, right? So clearly, originally it was a pure website oriented, then the mobile came, and then we had a few AMCs who had taken a lead there. SBI Mutual Fund, iPro, Reliance, they had taken a lead on the transaction side of digital, right? But when I took back Ajit, see, he was already my head of marketing. So I said, look, let's not do digital just as an ease of doing business, right? I want it to be holistically digital, end to end. So right from reaching the customer, getting him on board, going through the whole marketing funnel, right, the IDA, and then converting him. So when we do digital, we must do it proper end to end. And then again, the cost came to balk us in terms of how do we do it. And that's where I must thank whoever God you believe in above for bringing the pandemic down upon us. Because what in one shot the pandemic did was, one, of course, the lockdown closed down our offices.
Correct.
But the second is, we were amazed with the speed and alacrity with which customers and our distribution partners adopted to digital. So then it became like, oh, I can't be left behind. Now, whatever I've worked in preparing, I have to fast track it. And that's where, you know, over the last, whatever, 3 to 4 months, right? Though we've been gradually building legs of the digital, as you're aware with us in terms of our various new fund offerings, this new fund offer in the time of a pandemic allowed us the opportunity to explore the end-to-end digital framework. I think, so that's where we are as a journey. And it's been a very fantastic experience. Maybe we'll dwell into it a few minutes later. But it's been a fantastic experience, so much so that now for us, the only way forward is digital. So I'm not going to open any more offices. Whether I close some offices or not is a different matter. We'll see based on economics. But definitely, I don't need to open any more offices because the initial digital, as I call it, Digi Retail journey has been so welcoming and so heartening that I see now that our way future forward is absolutely going to be maybe wholly digital in a way.
No, that's very interesting to hear, Sunil, and I'll let David also come in. I think one of the things with the, you know, with Sundaram Mutual also has been, despite the pandemic, which has given a burning platform to move even faster, I think you and Ajit have been leading the way in terms of the digital journey, in terms of even interacting with customers, reaching customers, the creatives. You know, I think we have seen even on YouTube, like Sundaram Mutual, while on the AMC and AUM front may not be one of the top funds at the moment, but in terms of the way we have connected with customers, we have 143,000 subscribers on YouTube, right? Mm-hmm. So what prompted you like 2 years back to say, okay, let me start shifting my, you know, investments in media and the outreach to digital? I think even on channel partners, you all are doing the Vicecast, which is an initiative. So what prompted that over the last 2 years? Because that was before the pandemic itself and not...
So actually what prompted it was the fact that it was India's demographic, right? I keep talking in my webinars how India has the youngest population, working population in the world. And one of the things we figured was that the young guy is not going to, I mean, it started with the banking, our own banking experience. I realized it is ages since I visited a bank branch. I'm entirely dealing, but only in mutual fund, why do I expect somebody to walk into my office or walk into my distributor's office and then do? So I think that the way forward, the only issue was how fast this is going to take place. But otherwise, we were very clear that for the younger generation, right, mutual funds, and you know, the beauty is that the Indian mutual fund penetration is in single digits, maybe low double digits today. Okay, so the whole world is available, but if you're going to take that on, you have no choice but to go digital. So I think that was very clear. The key was, just like I like this favorite story about ATMs, you know, the first, I remember I was in State Bank then when ATMs arrived in India, it took 25 lakh rupees to set up one ATM, one machine. Okay. Nice. And sometime in the last 3 years, that was a trigger for me. IDFC Bank, which came into bank, said, look, I'm not going to build a single ATM. I'll rely on the network built by others. Right. So, and you know, there's a Murphy's law, which plays out in the whole tech world, right? That the half-life of everything that keeps shortening, right? So the more you delay investment in something hardware-ish or deep, you'll realize that you paid too much for it. So the key issue in my mind was the path forward was very clear. When do I time and what do I do? That was the main decision. And I think essentially it was that, the changing landscape of the marketplace in the financial world, you know, companies like Bank Bazaar, Policy Bazaar, all laying the way forward. And I think made it realize that if we are to expand, keeping our retail close to our heart, right, which as a group ethos will never go away, right? I realized that this is one. The second aspect was from a cost perspective. Right, the you know, in a digital world, we used to print 1 crore application forms for every NFO. Okay, so the sheer cost of doing that and billboards and everything made us try. And honestly, I think it's a wonderful world where you can make mistakes without too much cost. In the physical world, there are a lot of, you know, irreversible things which you do, and then you say, oh God, I went and spent 20 lakhs on this, 50 lakhs on this. I think the digital world allows you a lot of trial and error without really sinking that cost and doing that. So I think that was it. It was, like I said, the fact that the customer is becoming digital was very, very clear. And hence, there was no way we could ignore it. And that's the reason we started that journey, right? And the reach out to customers was, in our way, the first attempts were so phenomenally successful. As you'll be aware, our first webinars got more than 100,000 hits on YouTube, right? So I think that, in fact, probably from a timing perspective, right, I feel that we got it just right. In the sense, we were ready with everything when the pandemic hit, so we were able to quickly scale and take it to market.
You know, what's really interesting, Sunil, is that Sundaram has built such a trusted image for itself that it's no wonder that you have 100,000 people coming onto YouTube to listen because of the Sundaram name and the trust that's involved. And I think it's fascinating that such a conservative group, you know, what you outlined just now, in a matter of 2.5-3 years, your level of digital adoption is like a quantum jump. So it's really very, very encouraging. But my question to you is, you're deeply committed to retail. You have thousands of agents with whom you have deep relationships lasting decades. As you move digital, how do you see the future? I think it's very appropriate that you said, you know, future is, you know, hitting a six with digi retail. Yeah. So obviously you have a plan for the retail as well. Mm. Could you share that with us?
Yes. So the first thing is that the marketplace is also evolving, David. So the first is Bombay Stock Exchange, in addition to doing stock trading, has now adopted mutual fund transactions for execution. National Stock Exchange soon followed. The industry has also set up its own thing called MF utility, MFU, which allows interoperability within AMCs. So a lot of digital infrastructure is getting built around the ecosystem, right? And so for us then, what we realized was that for the customer, right? Today, distributors, right? Mutual fund distributors are finding that their marketplace is the whole of India. So practically what has happened with this whole OTP culture is that a distributor sitting in Tirunelveli is able to serve a customer sitting in Gangtok. Purely, only he can do this only through the digital world, right? And end of the day, he puts everything in the transaction through the OTP goes to the customer, customer enters that, the transaction is completed. So the ecosystem has, actually I should thank the ecosystem for that development. The second thing is the customer's awareness of digital. For example, I'll tell you, if you see the data on Demat accounts opened post the pandemic, they're mind-boggling numbers, right? So I think that, so today it becomes an imperative. So for me now, to I have this, the backend, and what is supporting me also, David, I must say, is that the our backend work is outsourced to something called a registrar and transfer agency work. So we have tied up with KFintech. And luckily for us, KFintech is also ahead of the curve in terms of digitalizing the backend operations. So I think that where the opportunity we saw was that the pandemic was the right tipping point where, because of the lockdown, the distributor could not visit his customer. So we converted that necessity into an opportunity where now I told, started telling the distributors, look, not only do you not have to visit the customer, you can get me to talk to your customer through Zoom. So earlier, for them to get Sunil Subramaniam to travel to Surat to meet up his HNI customer, today in one shot, that has become a seamless effort. So I think the whole, I would say, evolution of the marketplace in a digital way has been at the right time that we were able to capitalize. And so going forward, I don't see now a need to open another physical office in this country.
Yeah, I think what you've shared is quite fascinating because, like you've rightly been reinforcing time and again, what is facilitating this is digital. So even your distributors or agents are not tied to the company alone anymore because they're not tied by geography. They can get a customer anywhere because of digital.
Digital.
So their dependence on the company may go down, but you're still facilitating for them in multiple ways so that you are encouraging their growth.
Absolutely, David. And not only that, the beauty of the thing is that we were able to do the, how do I put a hybrid model between the physical and the retail. Let me explain this to you. So we used to advertise heavily in newspapers. Okay. Now the lockdown was just opening up. So when we did our NFO, there's a big challenge in front of us. Hey, do I advertise in my newspapers or not? Because we had a very good creative, okay, and which was very visible. But that customer, he sees the ad, but how is he going to transact?
Exactly.
Right? Papers are reaching him. He's reading the papers. How's he? So we came up with this wonderful idea of putting in a QR code into our advertisement. So all a customer needed to do was to just take his phone and scan that QR code, and his investment was done in three clicks. So we were able to get the normally physical customer in a time of the pandemic where he's within closed doors to actually execute purely digitally. So that is something which now that customer, having tasted digital, is not going to go back to physical. So somebody coined the word phygital for this. Part of it is physical, part of it is digital. So, you know, so I'm just saying that's a fascinating part of this whole journey is that how easy is it to do digital is realized only after you do digital. It's before that you hesitate. It's like getting into a marriage. You think, is she the right for me? Not for me, not for me. Then once you tie the knot, then you know, it all falls in place, right?
I think the convenience of digital is unmatched in, you know, in any form, anywhere else. And it facilitates just about everything. So yeah, what you're saying is true. But when you talked about end-to-end digital journey, have you considered that given the brand equity that Sundaram has, the brand loyalty, and the vast customer base that, you know, reinvests in Sundaram again and again and again, having a mobile app, because a Sundaram customer would like to have that.
Absolutely. So that's something which I've just finalized the deal with my backend. So we're going to be developing a dedicated both website come mobile app. So hopefully by the end of 2020, we would have that up and running. So the new fund offering that we just closed, right, where we got 60% of our 45,000 applications through digital mode, really then gave us that impetus, because until then we knew the future was bright, but how long was the tunnel before we saw the light? We were not sure. Now we are very, very clear that that's going to happen, you know, in a jiffy. So I think hopefully by the end of the year, we will have our own mobile app. And I will also start marketing hitherto what was considered unprofitable products. You take a liquid fund. Now in a liquid fund, everybody knows you get a better return than savings bank. But the money that we make is not great. So we can't incur great transactional costs in trying to reach every customer and convert him to a money fund application. But thanks to digital today, in our app, you're going to have a click of a button where you can do, and where today it can operate like a savings account. So, you know, like instant redemption up to 50,000 rupees. So we are trying to now make the Sundaram customer experience much more plain vanilla products. Whereas earlier, I was trying to sell them high-risk equity products, and that would in fact limit, because you see the typical Sundaram Finance customer is very conservative. So our penetration within the Sundaram Finance customer base was limited by the fact we didn't want to mis-sell a high-risk equity product to a typical fixed deposit customer. But reaching a very low-value product to him was proving a challenge because of the cost of the infrastructure of reaching him. Digital has now eliminated all of those and made it very easy. So I actually see that as the next growth step for us, is actually a simple product like a money fund.
Right. I have another question which is not directly related to digital, but it could come in at the second half of the journey. Given the, the removal of the security of fixed deposits in banks, because now if a bank fails,
correct,
you know, you can lose all your money and just be given 1 lakh.
Correct.
Have you seen a big shift towards deposits in companies like Sundaram Finance, which can then be translated to graduating them to things like mutual funds?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think that that is a bank that government allowed the Punjab and Maharashtra Cooperative Bank to fail. They allowed a bank in Karnataka to fail, has opened the eyes. In fact, it came to a stage where Sundaram Finance has to say, I'm not accepting deposit anymore, because if I take more money, I can't lend it. So what you're saying is actually happening. And that's the customer we want to translate into our debt funds, which can give you better returns, because as you know, mutual funds carry a taxation advantage over fixed deposits. So that's part of the target territory, that there is huge thing, because government is clearly signaling the capital guaranteeing of banks has got a limit to it.
Yeah.
So yes, that's a huge opportunity which beckons us.
Okay, over to you, Sunil.
Very fascinating insights, Sunil. I think I wanted to shift gears onto the branding front as well. You know, I've been doing very interesting campaigns and communication for the new fund launches, also revamping your website, I think, last year. So just wanted to spend some time on that. Should we first play some of the videos before we...
Please do that, so that people get a sense of what's happening.
Definitely. Let me pull that out. I'll just play 3 videos, short ones.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. read all scheme related documents carefully.
Let me not skip the disclaimer. So this is for another fund, which was equity fund. Absolutely. I think we had one more walk spot video as well. I'll just play that, which was a very interesting video on Father's Day, and then we can get it.
Home, he was given a huge welcome and Bihar's feeling. But I've come back home for Diwali and I'm stuck outside because my parents are out shopping. But it also makes me wonder if people know why we celebrate Diwali and why we celebrate it to this extent. So find out.
Story behind Diwali.
Ram comes back and then the festival of colors and that is Holi.
It's another day.
Dudha was born.
India is a country of festivals, so we need an excuse to celebrate.
Oh, you think Diwali is an excuse?
But he was sent out of his place, sort of like a solo vacation.
Ram did not go on one month, he went on a solo vacation.
It's a very big festival for Indians. It is the only festival where everybody has fun.
These are the people who know how to answer 16 mark questions, 2 mark answers.
हमारे जो महावीर भगवान थे वो मोक्ष गए.
It was when he returned back home after win over Lanka.
Good over evil thing, good wins over the evil.
The victory of good over evil.
Yes. Are you a good person or an evil person?
I am a hungry person.
This whole idea of good winning versus evil.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think is the evil that you have in your life that you need to get rid of?
I have something called online shopping. Keep buying and buying and buying.
Spend less time on social media.
When I'm on the road, I tend to shout at people.
Time management.
Bringing things in order.
There's something new that you want to start this Diwali. What would that be?
Be working on my health, not exercising.
Waking up early and going to bed early. Every dresser I buy, I should save cost. I spend on that.
Money save up on that.
I think I should start saving more. You know, plan better for the future. Or make better investments. Something to start. Yeah.
Think I should invest it in something my dad's been giving me inputs. Where do I get the best returns? I think mutual funds is a good way to start.
But not all of us know the reason why we celebrate Diwali, but we still do it with so much of happiness and pride. But all of us do know the reason why we should invest. But do we all do it? This Diwali, invest in yourself, invest in your family, and invest for a better future. Have a happy and prosperous Diwali. Have you invested yet?
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.
So very engaging content there, Sunil, both on the, you know, the Vox Pop videos, which make it very relatable. And obviously, I think most of the youth, we don't know about the Valley. So I think that was a clear insight from the video. But I think even the campaigns, the equity fund campaign with the mother and the nurtured growth and the, you know, sumo wrestling with the latest fund. So it'll be great to get your thoughts in terms of how do you, you know, conceptualize these NFOs, this communication and, you know, where does digital play a role in that communication as well? I think that would be the
thing. Thanks, Sunil. Actually, it all starts with retail, right? So to me, because retail is close to my heart, I want to make the mutual fund product accessible to the least common denominator of people. And one of the biggest challenges there is that over a lifetime, mutual funds have complicated lives. And, you know, we write there saying past performance cannot be guaranteed, subject to market risk. And then we come up with all kinds of fancy things like, oh, your large cap, mid cap, we still do that. So what happens is that while that is very sexy and makes people feel, it makes it less accessible because you're very wary about something which is this. So my thought process has always been that if it's retail, if I want to access that least common denominator, then I have to demystify it, number one. Take out all the halo around mutual fund. The second is use day-to-day analogies to tell them what it is doing, because then only you relate to it and correlate to it. right? So if you see here, let's take the, you know, the first one that you played, you showed a sumo wrestler wrestling, right? People now, first of all, think, what has wrestling got to do with mutual fund investments, right? So that curiosity to first see, why is a mutual fund app talking about wrestling, right? So you hooked him there, right? That's one. So first is, you, like they say in Hindi, they say, no, hatke se rehna chahiye. There's got to be a totally left field idea. That's number one. The second is then the product attributes you use to bring it through. So a wrestler, what? He's huge. So the first thing is a large cap fund. So size matters was our logo. So that, without my having to say anything, the logo of size matters with this huge sumo wrestler makes that point, right? Number one. Second, I talk about the fact that he's stable. Because the other guy is trying to push him, the wrestler doesn't get pushed. So the fact that these large cap companies are stable comes through in that process. The third is he's got to be agile because he's got to put the other guy down to the ground. So by using just the wrestling analogy, I was able to make all my points without using much of words, just a background to reinforce the thought. So that way, a complicated product was made very relatable. So you ask anybody what it is, at sometimes in the campaign, people started asking for the sumo fund, not for the blue chip fund. So that I would consider the biggest success, because then you have demystified it totally and you're saying, right. Similarly, to take us one on the nurtured growth, right? which was the other byline. Because what we wanted to show was that it's a multi-cap fund, which means it can do large cap, mid-cap, small cap. Now tell somebody that when the time is right, it'll go to large cap. When the time is right, it'll go to small cap. And which is the time, how? Whereas we use the mother to say that when a child is growing, she has to take care both of his enjoyment and of his studies and his career progression, and then she enjoys it. So by using that, we wanted to convey that this fund manager is going to take care of your investment like a mother takes care of his child. So that analogy that I'm in safe hands and that will be flexible as per my needs was made through in that point. So what drives the thought process here is try to put myself in the eyes of the customer, because I don't want to be selling a product. I want to be marketing a solution. So I think that's the fundamental difference. Instead of pushing a product, I want to create a solution that people should want to buy.
Complicating it as well. I think that's been definitely a core philosophy, right?
Absolutely. That's it. The simplification, I think, is the most important thing, because anybody is very wary of something that they don't understand at first sight.
Right.
Imagine ourselves as individuals, when you go and buy to a shop, we want things to be simple and not exercise my brain in doing that. And I think that's the mantra to ultimately to grow retail.
Right. And do you, like the Vox Pop, which we showed on the Diwali, do you think those kind of content like brands should do more of, or what kind of role do you think, in terms of connecting with consumers?
I think that's a very critical part of, again, decomplicating or demystifying mutual funds, because if you're trying to draw a parallel between something you do very regularly and something you should be doing regularly, right? So I think that the more we bring mutual funds close to the reality of a day-to-day life, and that's where one thing which I have believed in as a philosophy, and you'll notice that every time we talk about an ad, I push you on it, is that there must be a human element to it. Because that human, people associate everything with human attributes. So even a product, when it is humanized, then your comfort level with it becomes much higher. So I think that's where, celebrating Diwali, these are all normal day-to-day events. And if you see, our industry also through the mutual fund Sahiye campaign has been trying to do this in the series of commercials, right? So I think that is very, very important, because our main competitor, I'm sorry to talk about that, somebody from that industry might have spoken, but our main competitor, the insurance industry, has it made for it, because everybody realizes that insurance is vital for them, right? So, but for us, we've got to make them realize that mutual fund is vital for you.
Right. So that's the, with the growth of SIPs, reading in the Economic Times also, it's been an amazing time for SIPs especially, right? I think the retail investors.
Yes. Absolutely. And there again, Sunil, the way to market SIPs itself, people have been talking complicated terms earlier, like rupee cost averaging. The moment you use jargon like this, you put off people, right? Whereas you correlate the SIP to like savings EMI. Everybody is used to paying EMIs for their credit card or for their housing loan.
Right.
You position it like a savings EMI, you get through to people. So I think these are all the things which have helped the SIP boom to also start.
No, definitely, Sunil, absolutely.
So Sunil, I think it's very clear from what you've been saying that Sundaram Mutual has been an evangelist of sorts in getting people to understand mutual funds and therefore to invest in it more and more. You're graduating people from fixed deposits to mutual funds and so on.
Correct.
On this digital journey of your band, how do you see this evangelism role being carried out? One, of course, is in the kind of communications you talked about. Mm. What else have you looked at in terms of evangelizing the whole concept of mutual funds?
Yeah, so one of them is educating the investor about the whole scenario. Because today's individual is very hungry for knowledge. Today's individual, we found from a survey that people research two or three websites before they make a decision, right? So I think that from an industry where I feel we have taken a lead is in doing something called as the wise casts. Okay, where I do webinars, you know, live on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, talking about just economy, markets and investments. Okay, and I don't talk about products at all. The whole idea there is just to help them understand this whole complicated world of the stock markets better. And I do one every month and then we publicize it and pass it. So I think that is because ultimately we want all investors to make knowledgeable investments and not because somebody has just pushed them saying this is fantastic, it's given 20% per annum return in the past, it will give you that in the future, please come in. So we want to make people wise investors. So I think the logo that we have, the brand is Wise Investor. So we do these wise casts. So I think where the evangelism I see is that if I can get every customer to understand what they are buying and then buy. And I just don't want to simply push the product just because my company has certain goals to be met. So I think that's where I believe that, and whether that customer comes to my company or to another company, that's fine. As long as I have expanded the market, there's enough for all of us to eat from that table. So I think digital has given the opportunity to reach wide audiences, and two things have happened. One is there's one live audience, and then when it's on YouTube, people watch it at their own time and place. So second is you have a certain permanence, whereas if you do a physical meeting, once that is gone, you're gone from your memory, right? One. Second is, we also give opportunities for Q&A. So there's another series called Question Hour. Based on these webinars, I hold Q&A, where people who have gone through it can come and ask me questions and I answer. So the two-way interoperability or interaction of the digital world is phenomenal, which cannot be matched in a real physical world. So I think that's the way we see this. And I would like to think that we are among the leaders and the early adopters of this kind of a thing. And I like to then build that brand around the Sundaram as a caring company, which cares for your investments and wants you to buy the right investment, which suits your risk temperament, your goals and all of that. And not just an aggressive marketing company, which is out to stuff every product that it has down its throat. So I think that's something which is very important to us. The way we do our business is as important as the end result of our business.
This whole business of the wise casts, as you were saying, we are of course familiar with it,
but okay,
it is really important for listeners to know, yes, how well it is being done.
And mind you, I don't hesitate to take these meetings for as long as 1.5 hours. You know, and I found people were listening, but then I've toned it down to 45 minutes now because I don't want to do that. But I'm saying the hunger for knowledge, we don't realize it, how ordinary people are eager. And that's where even in the course of my webinars, I simplify the topic so that a layman can also understand complicated economic terms. So it's not just about coming and spouting a few jargon and going away. I take an effort to simplify the economic world and try and explain it to them. And I think that's where it's important that the content also match the reach of digital.
The beauty of it is that this is a category where it's very high involvement, high concern. And the warmth of being able to interact with somebody and learn and understand especially if it's the MD of the company, is unmatched. And therefore, they're willing to stay and listen and ask questions and so on.
And I never say no to any question, however difficult it is. You know, and that's not easy in these volatile times, I can tell you that.
No, that's really insightful, Sunil, on the Wisecast as well. I think shifting gears a little bit to the group itself, right? Sundaram, you know, the finance group, you'll have a few companies, including Sundaram Finance, Home Finance, Royal Sundaram as well, and Sundaram Mutual. So how do you see, you know, different industries within the four companies itself in terms of the digital transformation? And, you know, I think you'll have the platform called Sundaram Connect as well, right, to bring the four companies together. So if you could share some insights into, you know, from the key stakeholders' perspective, how is digital transformation happening, discussions for investments into digital transformation, automation. Obviously, a lot needs to be done, right? It's still from where we have to be for most businesses. When we are talking to the head of Rapido earlier in the previous session, so he was also saying we have done a lot of innovations during COVID, but still a long way to go in terms of where the end goal is. So if you could share some insights in terms of, you know, the digital transformation journey at Mutual versus like other groups, how you're bringing that together, you know, that could be good insights for other companies also to follow.
Absolutely. So traditionally, all of the businesses of the Sundaram Finance Group, which is what we are, that is Sundaram Finance, Royal Sundaram General Insurance Company, Sundaram Home Finance and Sundaram Mutual, historically have been brick and mortar, but very retail companies, right? Now, we took the lead in digital marketing and digital execution. Royal Sundaram has taken the lead in internal digital CRM, managing the agency network and all of that, right? So I think what has happened is jointly, the both of us, right, being the thing, are now driving this initiative to digitalize the entire group's efforts. Because in every business, right, whether it's in, they sell auto insurance, they sell health insurance, every business, the customer is actually gone far more digital than the manufacturer, sad to say. That's how the ecosystem had developed. So the pressure to go to digital, because the next wave of growth, right, is going to be digital. So naturally, our learnings there, right, are helping drive the group in terms of the digital way forward, one. Second is, what we've done, there are a lot of things we learned, wrongs, rights. They don't need to repeat that journey. They can straight away take the learnings and cut short the time to market. The third thing is that once a customer, always a customer, right? So two aspects to it, right? First is the customer has already built a confidence with an entity of the group. His confidence level to deal with another entity is very high, but you can't have each company separately operating the customer. So where a digital helps is in one spot. The ultimate vision is to have one Sundaram mobile app, a Sundaram website, where a customer can come and choose whichever product he wants. So actually, instead of cross-selling, we want to make it cross-buying, which is what in the digital world, it becomes very easy. That's one. The second aspect is that know your customer. Once you've done the basic due diligence, KYC for that customer, right? For you to then look at any other products based on his suitability becomes so much easier. There's a wealth of information available with, like, for example, we discovered that Sundaram Finance has 15 lakh customers, right? Yeah. Across various diaspora, whereas only 1 lakh of those deal in mutual funds. So we are like sitting with the butter in the hand and we're looking out. We haven't been able to tap that. Now, of course, there is a right product to sell. It's not that you can sell equity to every customer, his age, profile. So what this will help is it will have a pool of information on the customer available in one data storehouse, where you can then go and right market the right products to them based on their requirement and need. And finally, the greatest advantage of all of this is that, you know, in a paperless digital world, right, actually you'll have digital offices which are offering all products, right? So that's why we called it Sundaram Connect, because it's about connecting one to another. And from a simple cost perspective, in a non-digital world, I used to work with American Express, as you said. Right. Those years back, they had a study done with American Express, because it was also a multi-product company. They said it costs 42 rupees to acquire a customer. It costs only 8 rupees to cross-sell another product to an existing customer.
Right.
So straight away at 1/5 the acquisition cost. And in a digital world, I'm sure those economics are even far more better today. So I think it's a true win-win situation from a customer manufacturer perspective. Customer has the choice, manufacturer has the opportunity. So I think that's where the whole Digi Connect, maybe you call it that, right, is a big, big initiative. And I know that they are talking to y'all also in terms of, so wish you all the best in your efforts to pitch with them. But I see that, in a way, if you see, I think the Tatas, right, everything.
It's been in the news as well, right? They've been trying to consolidate their effort.
Consolidate, yes. And in fact, they are trying to charge a Tata brand cost to every company there, right? So I don't think we are headed in that way. But I'm saying that once a Sundaram customer should always be a Sundaram customer. Yeah. That's the.
I think like one very interesting that you brought up Tata, especially Sunil, because I think like one of the challenges with that group, at least from what we've heard, is that what is the cost of sharing, right? Like a Tata Click might have a lot of database, whereas or a Tanishq might have a large database, but another company won't have it. So if they're sharing, like one company feels I'm helping this other company, what am I getting in return, right? So how do you break those barriers in organizations, in terms of culture, to support each other? And how have you also looked at building your team for the digital journey? I think if you could share some insights on, building the team and the culture for digital innovation, I think that would, because given the setup is traditional and...
Yes. So I think in the culture aspect, I think that the key element is, I hate to say this, but you have to have a right blend of youth in the team. Okay, so in every team, you got to make sure there are a few youngsters who are going to challenge the status quo and not just accept the traditional methodology of doing things. So first things first in the culture is to inject youth and enthusiastic youth. I think that's absolutely critical. If you don't do that, right, you in your own world, you think that what you're doing is the best. Right, so that is one important thing. Second is cross-pollination from other industries. Right, you shouldn't be only hiring people from your own industry, like they did years ago to hire me from the banking industry, right? Like maybe like I took Ajit from the lending industry, the bank bazaar. So I think the cross-pollination is where then the digital too. You realize that the world outside is going spaces in digital you don't know, right? So I think essentially the biggest culture thing to break is this frog in the well attitude, right? Frog thinks the well is its whole world. I think the basic thing is youth, enthusiasm, and cross-pollination is one. Second is cross-functional teams at work within the workplace. Because there again, whatever you become a part of what you call that the group speak, they say, the thinking along the same lines. If for every project, right, especially true in the digital world, you have people from different functionalities at there. Right? That's a very critical, because what happens in digital is you're trying to solve one problem and create two other problems. So unless you take everybody together with you, right? So as a culture, teamwork is very important. And there in that teamwork, it's all very well nice to say, all be teamwork, all be friends, Indochini, bye-bye. No. I think the KRAs have to reflect that. When you set out the KRAs for them, right, you have to give specific weightages to group. Whether it is intra-company or inter-company within the group, right? So we, for example, this Sundaram Connect. So everybody, in every function in my company, there is somebody who's part of some Sundaram Connect group, whether it's marketing, digital, purchasing, anything. So we make sure that in the appraisal, their work there is recognized here. So people must feel that whatever work they are doing, they are being recognized. And so there where the leadership's role there is very important, that they take the inputs from the other companies in terms of their contribution in this and give it adequate weightage during the course. Because ultimately, there has to be that reward and recognition, for the efforts put in. So I think that as a culture is also, that's also important. And ultimately, none of this can work if you have a competitive mentality. The collaboration mentality must be nurtured, and that's a culture thing. That's where, when you hold a group meetings, right, you got to praise the people who have done well without murmur, without hesitancy, right? So I think that repeated stroking, like for a child, stroking of the mother is very important in the healthy growth. For culture, repeated positive strokes from the senior management is, I think, absolutely the glue which holds all of this together.
Sunil, I was really excited to hear about Sundaram Connect and the common database and the cross-selling and all that, because I think that's a precursor to the next level, where those 15 lakhs of customers that you talked about and, you know, across the group, starting with Sundaram Finance, you can, you know, the group companies have products that are beautifully positioned for customer lifecycle management. Yes. You know, depending on the stage of life, you've got products. So I think at some point, if it can come together, because digitally it can be planned, the right products can be offered at the right time.
Not only that, there's also a, how do you say, a cross, I don't know what the word is, it's cross is definitely there. The second word I'm not able to get, but I'll explain what I mean to you. So a person takes a housing loan. There's an EMI you pay. If you say that 10% of your EMI, you start an SIP, you can close your housing loan 5 years earlier than it is meant to close. Right? So that's what I'm. Similarly, a guy takes a auto car insurance. Right? Now you take insurance this year, but next year for the value of the car insurance, do you want to go scrambling for the money? Start a 12-month SIP to build up towards next month's insurance. So these products can work in tandem to help the customer to go together. So there is a lot of things that are there which are in the potential in terms of one product being used to match the needs of the other product. So that then the customer, you holistically own the customer.
Yeah, they complement in such a way the customer is empowered.
Correct.
And I think when that happens, the brand stickiness will become so, and you know, this whole ethos of Sundaram about building relationships, we're actually doing in the way we operate.
Absolutely. In fact, I don't know whether you've noticed the parents' logo is enduring values, new age thinking, which I think summarizes the whole digital, the culture as well as this thing. Because I think the right way to do the business, the right product to be offered to the customer, I think all of that are a responsibility.
Yeah.
No, thank you, Sunil. I think that's
thanks a lot.
Fabulous and a very insightful discussion. Any parting words to the participants as well in terms of the digital innovation? I think obviously different organizations are at different stages. So any parting words in terms of their journey for innovation and digital, digitization?
No, I think that the key, Sunil, what my learning has been is that the possibilities of the digital world cannot be thought of from outside of the digital world. You have to wet your feet and get in, and then you'll realize it's almost like Alibaba and the Wonder of Case and what you can do. Absolutely. Sitting outside, you just think of it. And so this fear of digital, I think that's the first step to overcoming it and realize that digital is the water in which we have to swim. So you just learn swimming, then you realize swimming is a beautiful experience, right? Similar to that, I think don't delay an entry into digital. It gives you the comfort of your ability to make lots of mistakes and recover from them and still progress forward. And, you know, so that comfort which digital offers to you, and in whichever industry you are in, believe me, the customer is far more digital oriented, digital ready, and digitally acting on multiple products. And if you are not gone digital, you are the one who's missing the boat.
Very well summarized.
Thank you, Sunil. I think it's always a pleasure, you know, interacting with you with all the positive energy and the encouragement you give everyone. So really glad you could take out the time despite a busy schedule. And, forays well into our next session as well. Our speaker is a digital first entrepreneur. Arjun is a founding member at M-Fine, which is one of the medicine and healthcare. So if you have the time, it'll be great to have you continue joining us for that session.
I'll try.
But thank you so much.
Anyways, congrats on this whole Digital Premier League and wish it all the best to all the
fans. Thank you, Sunil. Got inspired by cricket. By so thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, David. Thank you.
Thank you, Sunil.